Hi and welcome everyone to another episode of Let's Get FACTSinated, where each week we deliver a healthy shot of science and facts. If you're watching today, please say hi into the chat and let us know where you're watching from. Thank you for joining. So we do two things on this show. We answer your questions about vaccines and the pandemic, and we all learn how to effectively communicate science, because it's by sharing science is how we keep our communities safe. So if you don't know me, my name is Lucky Tran. I'm a biologist and science communicator based at Columbia University in New York, and I'm the managing director for March for Science. So yeah, it's been a huge week again in the pandemic, right? I hope everyone is hanging in there. You're doing well because, you know, there's a lot of information right now and it's a lot to process and we've been through a lot. So I think this is an important episode today because we're going to talk about the new CDC guidelines, the new data on Delta variants, and, you know, everything that's been happening in public health over the last week and where we're heading in the pandemic now. And more importantly, what we can all do to keep our communities safe. So I'm so excited to welcome back to the show Dr. Katelyn Jetelina, who is AKA your local epidemiologist, who does wonderful, wonderful work doing science communication primarily on Facebook, but other Substack as well and other forms. If you haven't checked out her Facebook, go give it a like right now, because honestly, it's where I get a lot of, you're one of my trusted sources. It's where I get a lot of my information. When there's a new CDC drop of new guidelines or a new study coming out, and I want a little bit more context than what I'm seeing in the news, I go to your page and I have a look at it. So thank you so much for your work. How are you feeling today, Dr. Katelyn?
I'm tired.
I'll bet.
Exhausted. It's been quite the week for public health, specifically public health communication. So it's been busy, yep. But happy to do it.
Yeah, thank you for joining us. And please, everyone out there this week, send a lovely thank you message to all your public health peeps, to all your doctors, to all your scientists, all your epidemiologists, anyone who's working on this, because it's been a lot. We're going through a lot at the moment. So really appreciate everyone's work. Really appreciate your work. And so I guess we should start by talking about what happened this week, right? And so the first thing that we should talk about is the new CDC guidelines. I just pulled them up there. So the CDC updated their guidelines, which include fully vaccinated people, and in particular, this masking requirement. So I think the big line here is really the one which says, added a recommendation for fully vaccinated people to wear a mask in public indoor settings in areas of substantial or high transmission. So that's a big update, right? And so what brought this on, Dr. Katelyn? And, you know, why did the CD, you know, a couple of months ago, they dropped their masking requirements? Very contentious decision in public health community and the wider community at large. Why has it changed now?
Yeah, so I mean, if we go back, I mean, to May, if we remember, transmission was pretty low, it was decreasing, Delta didn't take a stance yet in the United States, and we really needed to figure out ways and strategies to improve vaccine hesitancy. And so those are really the reasons why the CDC dropped mask recommendations for vaccinated. 2 months, you know, later, Delta is 90% prevalent in the United States. We have really high transmission rates. We're having outbreaks. You know, the South is on fire right now. And then we got, or at least the CDC saw some unpublished data that was actually published today, saying that vaccinated can transmit the disease. Specifically, vaccinated outbreak cases can transmit the disease or transmit the virus. And that really changes the game. And so they changed their stance that masks need to be among vaccinated.
Yeah, absolutely. So I guess a question that I get a lot is, why did they drop it in the first place? Which is a tricky sort of conversation to have. And then this, what is this new data? Because we've been seeing what's happening in the UK and Israel and India, right, with the Delta variant. What was sort of the big drop this week that sort of made the CDC go, oh, this new data puts it over the top and we need to change our recommendations again?
Yeah, so there was a really big outbreak up in Massachusetts that they followed real closely. They had lots of investigators on it, and it was about 400, 500 cases. And 75% of those cases were vaccinated people. I think there were five people that went to the hospital. Four of them were vaccinated. One was the unvaccinated. And so this, I think, really perked the ears of the CDC to show that breakthrough infections and breakthrough cases are much higher among the vaccinated compared to Alpha or other variants before. And we really need to pay attention to it, and we need to act appropriately for Delta.
Right, absolutely. And I think if I bring up the guidelines again, they say substantial or high transmission. I don't have the map right here to show, but there is a map. We'll drop it in the comments, which can help you translate that. Maybe you could talk about that recommendation rather than a universal recommendation. They're saying areas which are substantial or high transmission. How is that defined, and how can we work out if that's our area?
Yeah, it's hard. And honestly, from a communication standpoint, from a scientific communication standpoint, I wish they just said everyone. And I think it would have been a lot more clear and a lot easier to know if you need to wear a mask or not. But they didn't. And so how you can decide, or they have a map on the CDC website that, you know, if your county is red or orange, which basically means more than 50 cases per 100,000 in the past 7 days, or so not and, but or your test positivity rate is greater than 8%, that means transmission is very high in your community and everyone needs to wear a mask indoors.
Right, absolutely. We'll drop that link in the comments so that you can see. And I, as a science communicator, I absolutely agree with you. And really, the stance is, you know, I think we are in a pandemic. You know, a lot of different, there are a lot of complexities, and different places affect each other. So it's never a bad thing to take extra precautions when you see what's happening around you, right? So, you know, I think that's the main takeaway.
Yeah, especially with this Delta, you know, we are learning things. I keep saying we're building the ship as we drive it, right? So
right.
I rather, from a public health standpoint, be more cautious and take away measures than try and implement them after everyone's over wearing masks, for example. But I'm low on the totem pole, I guess.
Aren't we all? But I think our voice does matter. Like, the community voices matter. And, you know, it's really, we're working together. As you say, we're building, you know, the plane as we fly, right? So I think that's really important. And you're right. My mantra is always prevention is better than a cure, right? It's better to prevent than to react. And so taking precautions before you see the cases really ticking up in your community is a good thing. So that's never a bad thing. All right, so we have a lot of questions, as you know, probably we should expect in reaction to the guidelines this week. I'm sure you've been getting a lot of them to your inbox, Dr. Katelyn, but hopefully we can sort of navigate a lot of the common ones today and sort of help everyone sort of make sense to it. And I do want to acknowledge it is hard, right, to have like guidelines saying one thing a couple of months before and then to them to sort of slingshot back the other way. Some of this is, I do feel like the communication side of this could have been done a lot better. But also, in a pandemic, the nature of the game is things do change. In science, things do change. And that's definitely hard as a human trying to navigate through life. And that's something, you know, we're all very empathetic with. At the same time, it is important that we pay attention and we spread the word, because this has a tangible result in terms of saving lives and protecting people who are vulnerable in the community. So we appreciate everyone for, you know, navigating all these tough rules and changing rules and guidelines through life at the moment. So thank you, everyone, for your work. So yeah, let's get into these questions. So I guess obvious question is, how much do the vaccines protection the vaccines offer against Delta? If a vaccinated person tests positive, is illness less severe? Maybe you could give a rundown on, in light of Delta compared with what we've been told before, how effective are still the vaccines? Thank you, Elise, for that question.
Yeah, it's a good question. And I think it is actually confusing to a lot of people to keep track of this. I think, we know that the vaccines continue to protect against severe disease, which is fantastic news. I think the bigger question is how much do the vaccines protect against asymptomatic and mild disease, or even moderate? And we're not entirely sure or confident on those numbers. But to me, the big thing that matters is it's keeping people out of the hospitals, which is a fantastic step and a fantastic piece of protection for ourselves.
Right, absolutely. And I don't think anything changes in terms of the broad pitch for the vaccines, right? They're one of the amazing tools that we have to fight this pandemic. They're one of the amazing tools we have to get case numbers down, to keep people out of the hospital. We're trying to figure out the specific details on how much, and therefore masking is an added recommendation, right? Because we want to get cases down as quick as possible, because there's still many people who are vulnerable, whether they're not vaccinated or they're immunocompromised, et cetera. So it's good to do those things, right?
Yeah, the best protection is this layered approach, right? So we have really great vaccines, but they're not perfect. We knew they weren't perfect, and so that's why we need masks and to wash hands and to stay outdoors and social everything we're all sick of hearing.
Yep. And the more we do it, the closer we get. But it's a little bit longer, which is, I know it's tiresome, but it's really important. It really does have an effect. So in terms of, I know right now we're going on, I guess, 6 months, 6 to 8 months that the vaccines have been available in the US. So here's a question for generally, how concerned are we that healthcare workers may have waning immunity right as Delta peaks? Because that was most healthcare workers 6 to 8 months ago. And I guess that's the broader question, right? Is how long does immunity last? What do we know about that right now, given that most people going into fall, which is, as we know, can be a vulnerable period, are we worried about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think this question comes up a lot this week because of this new report from Israel showing that there's higher likelihood of breakthrough cases among those that were vaccinated in the beginning of the pandemic compared to those who are vaccinated in the past couple months. And so there is a worry about waning immunity. The thing that I'm a little skeptical about, though, is that, our immune systems are incredibly complex. And antibodies isn't the only level of protection our body has. In fact, we expect antibodies to decrease over time because we have other layers of protection like B cells or memory B cells or even T cells. And so, I know we're continuing to look at this. We're looking at it very closely with booster shots. I think healthcare workers, those that are over 60 and immunocompromised, may be seeing a booster shot a lot sooner than the general public in the United States. Oh, there we
Right.
go. What
And
about booster
there we go. That
shots?
was the question. Thank you, Noel, for that question. And thank you for answering that. Yeah,
Yeah, booster shots
absolutely.
would help. Yeah, they would. We've seen quite a few studies come out from the vaccine sponsors that are testing booster shots right now, and they do increase neutralizing antibodies. The other thing that booster shots may help with, specifically given the evidence we've seen this week, is they may help vaccinated spread the virus even less. And so there's a lot of interesting hypotheses circulating around right now in the United States that if we need a booster shot, we know France is doing it. We know the UK is planning on it September 20th. We know Israel's already doing it. And so it may be time for the United States to start talking about it too.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, in terms of, I guess, cases, breakthrough cases, what do we know about breakthrough cases? Vicky says, in particular, for the subset of vaccinated elderly, right? So maybe more vulnerable, ordinary, more vulnerable people. What's the data on the severity of symptoms from Delta?
Yeah, so breakthrough cases overall are much more mild than unvaccinated cases. I think the interesting question that Vicky put in here was among elderly. And that is, again, why we're thinking about a booster shot, because the severity of a breakthrough case is higher among elderly, among immunocompromised. So which tells us that they're not fully protected as we would like them to. And so this is continuing our conversation about booster shots. It's a great question.
Right. It is a great question. And immunocompromised people as well, I guess, might fit in that category, right? Anyone who might have, we might suspect has, you know, that vaccines aren't as effective for them for whatever reason.
Exactly.
And I know there's a lot of understandable anxiety about hearing about breakthrough cases. We see them on Twitter, we see them on the news, right? So maybe put into context, you know, what's the breakthrough rate for the vaccines?
It's very, very small. I don't know the exact rate actually, but I know it's incredibly small. And like you said, we keep hearing anecdotal evidence of breakthrough cases, and these are important to track and to know of. Mm-hmm. But I think we often forget about the denominator of actually how many people, millions and millions of people are vaccinated in the United States that haven't had a breakthrough case. You know, and then the other important aspect is we need to talk about the severity of that breakthrough case, right? It's very different mm-hmm. if you have an asymptomatic breakthrough case like the Yankees have compared to a breakthrough case on an ICU on a ventilator, for example. And so it's important to keep that in context in the broader landscape we're dealing with right now.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's sometimes extremes with these things in that I think, you know, sometimes the headlines might be a little misleading. At the same time, we can't ignore them because if you look at breakthrough cases, they, you know, people are still getting long COVID from breakthrough cases. There's still some outcomes that we want to preferably avoid if we can take measures to prevent them, right? And so it's important that we still talk about breakthrough cases, monitor, study them, etc. I always feel frustrated with this sort of push-pull of extremes. Like, we don't think about them, or like we over sort of exaggerate how we present them. So I think that's really important too. In terms of, have scientists determined what makes Delta more transmissible? I think people have heard a lot about this higher viral load. Do you know what the latest research on that area is?
Yeah, so there's a few mutations on the spike protein. So the spike protein is important because it's the key into our cells. And so when that key changes, we need to know and we pay close attention to it. And so there's a few mutations on the spike protein that makes it more sticky to our cells. So it can latch on a lot easier and transfer into our cells a lot quicker. And so that on a micro level, that is really what makes Delta more transmissible. Same with, you know, the South African variant, same with the UK variant, et cetera.
Coming back to the vaccines, I don't think we broke it down into different vaccines because, of course, we have the J&J shot and the mRNA vaccines, right? So is the J&J shot less effective on Delta compared with the other variants? And I guess what that might that mean for boosters in future? Thanks, Kimberly, for that question.
Yeah, it's a good question. And I continue to be frustrated about the lack of information from Johnson & Johnson about this vaccine. So a weeks ago now, I'm having a hard time with time, we saw a lab study, so a Petri dish study, saying that the J&J vaccine still works to some extent against Delta. We don't necessarily, though, have a real-world study on this about the effectiveness of J&J in the real world. And there's a lot of people questioning this because it's a one-dose regimen. If we're already starting to talk about three doses for Pfizer and Moderna, do we need a second dose for Johnson & Johnson? The important also thing to recognize is Johnson & Johnson also has a clinical trial out right now for a two-dose regimen. So it would be really nice to see that preliminary data as well.
Right. Circling back to breakthrough cases, Crystal says she has a breakthrough case. We're sorry to hear that, Crystal. We hope you get better very soon. Your family and you were vaccinated. And so I guess the question is, should she quarantine if they're all vaccinated and her family members are testing negative, but she's positive with the virus? So what's the rules for isolation if you're a vaccinated person, you have a breakthrough case and you're living with other people? I guess that depends on if they're vaccinated or not.
Yeah, I think it depends if they're vaccinated or not. You know, I think this is also going to perhaps change with the new data that came out like 4 hours ago. You know, before we didn't think that vaccinated could, even if they are a breakthrough case, could spread the disease. And now that we know that they can. I think officially CDC says you do not need a quarantine, but if it were me and my family, I would definitely quarantine. I wouldn't go to the grocery store. We need to keep transmission as low as possible right now. And that needs to be the goal of the greater public.
Yeah, agreed. That's anyone who asked me this question is caution is not a bad thing at the moment. And I understand it can sometimes be hard, right? So, you know, sick days, not everyone has a lot of sick days, et cetera. But so that's something we have to be cognizant of. And I guess that's something we should be advocating for is sort of more understanding policies from employers, et cetera. But generally, caution is a good thing. Thank you for that question. In terms of, I guess, the question with masks, right? So now masks, like more people, you know, they're going to bring them out of the closet. Hopefully you've been wearing them most of the time, but, you know, what's it, with the variants, is there any change in practice? Is there a different type of mask that will help? Is there anything that has changed here? Thank you for that question, Rebecca.
Yeah, good question. So no. So, you know, N95s, KN95s are still like top-notch protection for us. Second is double masks. I know we're annoyed of masks, but wearing two of them, right? A surgical one with a cloth mask works great. The other thing that works great is a surgical mask that is tied at the side. So there's not so much air in between your mask and your face. Also seems to work great. Cloth masks don't work very well, but I will say they're better than nothing. And at this rate, at least in Texas where I am, I would rather see cloth masks than no masks. So there's definitely better masks than others, but a mask is better than nothing right now.
Yeah, I want to echo that too. And I do hear and I do understand. I think we're in a better position than March last year, right, in terms of availability of masks on the market. But I also understand that N95s can be expensive too, right? And so, you know, there are generally a mask is better than no mask. I guess the other thing I would add is that it's, as you were saying before, Katelyn, it's layers of protection, right? So you don't want to stress test your vaccines. You might want to think about what activities you're undergoing, avoid crowded activities in poorly ventilated spaces, even if you have a mask. It's like any other intervention, just having that one thing isn't going to be a miracle thing, and then you can do whatever activity you want. It's all about minimizing risk where you can.
Exactly. Absolutely. I agree.
What about, okay, so activities now, people have been enjoying the summer and being able to do more, which is nice. But do things change now? Like in terms of, Jerry asks, please discuss the safety of dining indoors in restaurants, for instance.
Yeah, so this is a very real type of question. Indoors is more risky than outdoors, especially for eating and not wearing masks, especially if you're in a high transmission area. I would stick to outdoor dining. It sucks right now in Texas. It's really hot. But I think that dining indoors can be more risky, especially if it's up to 100% capacity. I would certainly worry about this. And I would also worry about it if it's not ventilated well. And that it's kind of dependent on the restaurant and their policies.
Yeah, absolutely. And then another question coming up, with schools going to return in a lot of places, right? That's a big question at the moment. I think people are thinking about their families and what they should do depending on your area. And so mask mandates are coming to place in some areas, right? Are mask mandates enough? Michelle says she's concerned about sending her kids even with a mask mandate. So I guess the question generally is of, you know, how does the Delta variant change how we're thinking about returning to school in fall?
I mean, if my ideal world, all kids and teachers will wear masks, vaccinated or not, they would have surveillance testing, involuntary surveillance testing. So testing once a week in pods so you can catch outbreaks. And then also really highly ventilated classrooms. Get that air moving. Now, I say that's my ideal world because implementation is not that ideal. Some schools don't have the resources to do surveillance testing. Some schools don't even have mask mandates. In Texas, it's illegal to have a mask mandate at a school. And so it's a spectrum of protection. And unfortunately, parents are put in a really tough position right now on how to navigate those schools and those decisions. And so we have to really come to this from an individual perspective. And so know that, you know, masks do work on kids, especially if they're fit well, especially if they have filters on them. There's a couple on Amazon, for example, KN95s that look and work fantastic. And we can just do the best of the circumstances we're provided.
Yeah, and I want to just echo that this is really a tough time, particularly for families navigating this complex landscape, right? And that's understandable. So, you know, please look towards your community, look towards experts like Dr. Katelyn and sort of have these discussions, get them out there in the open. There's no one fits all solution, you know, but it's important that we do talk about safety and that, you know, we have those conversations with our schools, with our, you know, teachers, our fellow parents, you know, because nothing's to be gained to not thinking that, you know, there's no risk or just forging ahead. I think it's important that we have conversations about the safety of our communities and come together around this.
Another person that families can have conversations with is their pediatricians. And so I had a conversation with two of my girls' pediatricians about whether I should take them out of childcare or not. And so they had some really helpful advice about how to weigh the risks with the benefits. From the child's health perspective. And so that's another person people can turn to for trusted information.
Thank you for that. That's a great recommendation. I know many wonderful pediatricians doing great work at this time. So in terms of, I know we talked about restaurants before, a lot of people are still on vacation, right? So is there any data on how safe air travel is with Delta? And should we start thinking about rethinking, you know, a lot of people did go off on summer holidays after getting vaccinated. Should we be rethinking our mobility at this time?
Yeah, so we don't have quantified risk about air travel. We didn't actually have this for a while in the start of the pandemic. So this, it comes, you know, it's a trickle down effect. The thing that I feel confident about, at least on airplanes, is that masks are mandated federally. And some airlines actually do a really great job at enforcing masks too. And so I actually feel pretty comfortable being on a flight. They have really good air filter systems, again, mandating and then also enforcing masks. So that's on an individual level. On a population level, the problem comes when we have, like, for example, the South is burning right now. And people from the South then go bring it up to the North and start the fires up there. And that is a different type of conversation on a population level, if we should stop air travel or not. But again, a tough decision. And sometimes people don't have options to travel on planes. They have to for work. And I am pretty confident that they're safe, even with Delta.
Okay, thank you for that. And what about family gatherings similarly? Kathleen says she has a wedding planned and most people going are vaccinated. Doesn't have details on venues or hotels. But after the Provincetown, she's concerned. So what are some rules to apply when we're thinking about group gatherings at the moment?
Yeah, you know, I think being concerned is correct. I would definitely stay vigilant. I don't know if I would go if it was, I wouldn't go if it was indoors. I would feel a lot more comfortable if it was outdoors. Kathleen said that the majority of them are vaccinated. I would be curious to know what majority is. And if you do know people who are vaccinated, stick with them closer. But yeah, it's tough. We all want to get back to normal, but we're just not going to if we continue going to these large events. And the risk is not zero if you're vaccinated. We saw that in Massachusetts. And so to keep that in mind is important.
Yeah. And I guess another thing, and I echo that personally, I'm probably not going to most out at, you know, group gatherings at the moment. And I do, you know, and I understand it's hard for some people, but it is something that we should take seriously and evaluate the risks, not just for yourself, but for your community, because it's something, yeah, you don't want to get wrong, I guess, because the consequences can be big. So it's something that we should weigh carefully. And the other aspect to that is, you probably know these studies, I don't know all the details, but birthday parties, right? Like some of those birthday parties were shown to, you know, be in family members were shown to be spreading events. And part of that is because you let your guard down around people you love, which is understandable, right? You know, as opposed to going in a store, sometimes you go, oh, we're going to mask up. There's not a lot of ventilation. Sometimes in social situations, you let your guard down. And so that's something to weigh, I think, as you're thinking about these social gatherings with family members and friends, not to just assume, like you were saying, that, oh, everyone's vaccinated, it'll be fine. But, you know, sort of these are hard conversations, but I think it's healthy to have these conversations.
They're really hard conversations, and they're really tough decisions to make. But I feel like everyone at this point has a general, I would hope, understanding of risk tolerance, their own risk tolerance, and more risky activities than non. And everyone just needs to be responsible.
Yeah. So should we be masking outdoors too? I know the recommendation is for indoors. I know there's some studies, for instance, there was a music festival in Holland, I believe, that was a super spreader event, not masked outdoors, a few thousand people. Is that something people should be thinking about?
Yeah, so I think you bring up a really good point in that, what does this outdoor event look like? If I'm at the park with my daughter, no, you shouldn't mask up outdoors. Now, if you're shoulder to shoulder at a concert screaming and it's stagnant air and everyone has masks, I mean, yeah, maybe you should be masking up outdoors. Lollapalooza right in Chicago right now. It's making me very nervous that none of those people are masking, even if it's outdoors. And so it depends on the situation. It depends how it is. It depends if there's a breeze or not. It depends, again, who's vaccinated, who's not. So I hate to make a blanket statement like that. It's really situation dependent.
Yeah, absolutely. The main thing is doing a risk assessment on these sort of activities before you go. That's really important. But yeah, I'm getting nervous with some of these outdoor events that are being held or scheduled too. So yeah, hopefully they work with public health agencies on making sure that they are safe. Right. Into policy question, this one from Russ, actually. Why are we requiring masks instead of requiring shots? Wasn't the mask mandate only there to help until we had vaccines? What's your take on that policy question? I know that's a spicy one.
No, it is spicy, but it's fair. I appreciate that question, Russ. I think that policy isn't determined based on science. Policy is a combination, well, sometimes hopefully, with science and public demeanor. And I think we are seeing that happen in real life. You know, we poll after poll after poll says, you know, people would rather their employers or the governments strongly suggest vaccines than mandate them. And we need to take that feedback seriously, because if we start mandating it, it may push back. Now, do I agree with that or not? I don't know. I think it's time for the stick opposed to the carrot approach for this. But I think on a policy level, that's why we're seeing it this way.
Right. And there's also the aspect, I sort of get it, is just like, if your most powerful tool is the vaccine, why are you doing masks, you know, in terms of policy as well? But it's like we were saying before, with this more transmissible variant, layers of protection are important, right? And not everyone is vaccinated yet. It'll take, and the surges are happening now, right? So it'll take some time to get fully vaccinated. And I think some data says that the first shot even isn't quite as effective on the Delta variant as it was on previous variants. So when you're in an emergency situation, you want to use the tools that you have that can be employed quickly. So I think mask mandates make a lot of sense in terms of having this different tool that can be used quicker and get those cases done, because you want to act as quickly as possible.
Yeah. And the other thing is, I mean, you can see masks, right? You can see mask mandates. It's a little more difficult to enforce vaccine mandates. But it's incredibly complex policy question. And I guess I'm glad I'm not in charge of policy right now.
That's right. We'll probably discuss more about vaccine mandates on this show in the future. So we'll table that one for now, but appreciate your perspectives, Dr. Katelyn. I'm going to look through the audience. Thank you. We have so many questions. Thank you, everyone. We really appreciate you tuning in. I think having these conversations are really important, right? Because it's natural to have these conversations. Guidelines change, and it's natural to understand why are these guidelines changing, and what does that mean for me in the real world? How do we act in regards to them? I'm not sure if you see anything there on the side, Dr. Katelyn, let me know. What about in terms of immunocompromised people? Do we know, is there any data? So this one's specifically for cancer patients, but do we know generally on data for immunocompromised people? And is there any data on for the Delta variant specifically? I guess it's pretty early on that, right?
Yeah, it's a little early with the Delta variant. Before Delta, though, we did see quite, I think we have up to like 60 studies on immunocompromised. And organ transplant patients and certain cancer patients, the vaccines just don't work on or very reduced efficacy. I think it's a lot of blood cancers that particular. And so this is what's really driven the conversation of having that booster shot for immunocompromised. And frankly, I think it's time. You know, at the ACIP meeting at the CDC last week, they're saying that it's time for a booster shot for immunocompromised. I know that they can't recommend it until the FDA does, though. So we're waiting on the FDA.
Right. Absolutely. So here's an interesting one. I think this is one of those things that has been pervasive. Does the 6-foot rule still apply? I'd love your take on that in terms of guidelines, because I think with ventilation, how airborne the virus is, that's been an interesting discussion. We've had something, the 6-foot rule at the start of the pandemic, it's something that keeps going on. But I think we have more sort of clearer rules that we can apply right now, right? I'm not sure what your take on that is.
Yeah, the 6-foot, this is a good question. I mean, the 6-foot, I don't know, honestly. I don't know. I don't know how that was effective that was before, and I don't know how effective that is with Delta. The 15-minute rule is decreased by a lot just by how sticky Delta is. It's so much easier to transmit, and it's so much easier to get infected if you get it transmitted to you. And so I would certainly think that 15-minute rule is much less. I know the next question is then what, how many minutes? And I don't know. Right. I would be careful at any minute interval if you're next to someone you don't know their vaccination status. Or now they're not wearing a mask. I would just be careful no matter who you're talking to.
Absolutely. And I guess the thing with the 6-foot rule that was interesting to me, I guess it was a rule of thumb at the start. And I don't know, I sort of feel like sometimes the conversation didn't go into ventilation. Like if you're in a crowded indoor space, right, where the windows aren't open, you know, like the idea that 6-foot is magical, it really isn't. It's complex, right? And so you have to weigh up a lot of different factors.
I think you're right. It is complex, and you're right. We do know ventilation's really important. And so, I mean, we've seen that a lot in the school studies this past year, that, you know, those barriers between desks don't work, the taking temperatures doesn't work very well, but what works is ventilations and masks. And so we're learning as we go. And you know, it doesn't hurt being 6 feet away from someone either. But I honestly, I don't know if it's effective or not.
Yep, absolutely. Shout out introverts, by the way. So yeah, Matt has this question. Just read that it's as contagious as the cold. Is this BS? So there was an interesting chart from that CDC slides, right? I'm sorry, I don't have it right here. And headlines this morning that is as contagious as chickenpox, right? That's the headline that's going around. Maybe you could put that in context. What does that mean? I don't know. I guess my reaction to that is I feel like that makes sense to me, but does everyone know how contagious chickenpox is? Do you, I don't know what your perspective on that is, or what's the best way to communicate how much more infectious Delta is?
Yeah, so it's serious, right? So before MERS and SARS, I think, is about an R naught of one. Variants before Delta were an R naught of like two, and I'll explain what R naught means. Then comes smallpox, then comes chickenpox, then comes Delta, and then comes measles with an R-naught at about 16. So it's not as contagious as measles, but it's contagious with an R-naught of chickenpox, which is about 8. So what that means is on average, one person will infect 8 other people. And that is a pretty pretty scary infectious rate. We knew it was highly infectious. We've been screaming from the towers that it's, you know, 200% more transmissible, but now we actually have a number behind that, which I think gives it a lot more meat to the general public.
Yeah, I did actually find this chart. That's the chart we're talking about.
There we go. Yeah.
Blue box. I don't want to show too many charts because sometimes charts can be, you know, the internal charts can't be too useful. But I think that's a good summary of where it fits on the scale. The other question with this, actually, I know people talk about the progression of the pandemic and these mutations. I think actually we might have a question here. If you just bear with me and I can find it. Okay, here we go. How long until the next variant mutates? Will COVID get more contagious and lethal as time goes on? Because I know sometimes we look at those charts and sometimes there's this inverse proportionality, right? And like the severe ones, not too transmissible, the more transmissible ones sort of get weakened, right? But do we know, you know, as we're worried about Delta variant, should we worry about Epsilon? What's the sort of way to think about the pandemic going forward?
Yeah, we should worry that the virus is mutating, and it will continue to mutate. In fact, the more we transmit it, not just in the United States, but the world, the more opportunity we have to give it to change. We don't know whether that's going to be tomorrow or that's going to be never. But it is mutating at a pretty high rate. It's not mutating as high as flu, but it is mutating a whole lot more than, for example, measles. And will it get more contagious and lethal? It slowly is. For example, we have Delta Plus right now. We have Lambda that is getting more contagious and lethal just because the virus is understanding what's working, right? So it's finding those mutations that spread really easily among humans. And we continue to stress the virus to do that and challenge the virus to do that, and we need to stop. So we are worried about the virus mutating.
Absolutely. So Vivian has a question. What are the recommendations for protecting newborns and infants right now? I guess what a lot of people worried about is that, you know, we still need to get adults vaccinated, a lot of adults vaccinated, of course, but there are a population of people, namely kids and infants, who can't get vaccinated. So with Delta around, is there anything that we need to change in reaction to protect that vulnerable population?
Yeah, not really. So I have a almost 10 month old, and what I do, I don't let her be around anyone that's unvaccinated, honestly. When my girlfriends, even if they're vaccinated, want to hold her, I ask them to wear masks. I took them out of childcare just this past week because I found out that the teachers were unvaccinated and not wearing masks. And so, yeah, we need to advocate for our kids. You know, the CDC still says that kids under 1 year old are high risk. And I take that very seriously as a mom and as a scientist, and try and protect her as much as we can until she can get a vaccine, which unfortunately is not going to be till 2022. So we still have a while to protect those little ones.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, why layers of protection is very important, because it takes time to roll out vaccines to all the population.
The other thing I wanted to mention here, so I had my daughter before I was able to get the vaccine. So if you're pregnant right now, and get the vaccine, your infant and newborn will get some level of protection just through the placenta, through breast milk. And so I'm actually very jealous of moms that can have the vaccine while they're pregnant, because I wish I could have given my daughter that level of protection. So we know that moms transfer antibodies to their fetuses and to their newborns. And so that's one way you can also protect them.
Yeah, and I think that's a really great point, because I know there are a lot of expecting mums who are worried about getting the vaccine, right? And I think that's a positive thing, a talking point to, you know, encourage people to get vaccinated. And that's very reasonable, right? Because you're at that point, you're being careful about, you know, your health at that point. But that's a really positive talking point. And at this time, it's important to talk to people about the benefits of vaccines.
Yes, absolutely.
Not sure if you know this question. We were talking about ventilation before. I know I follow a lot of aerosol scientists on Twitter who I get this information from, but I think it's a good question. How can a person determine the level of ventilation adequacy in a room? That's a tricky one, isn't it? I know some people are carrying out around carbon dioxide monitors and using that. I don't know what your best sort of tips or best way to explain that.
I have no idea. And this is a good question. I guess the way I kind of judge it is if I feel a little breeze indoors, if that makes sense. But that is completely not scientific at all. So I'm not entirely sure. What are you seeing on the Twitter world about this?
Now, I haven't dived into the studies. It's more that there are monitors that some people are carrying around to sort of gauge, you know, sort of the vent. But that's not really possible or practical for most people. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so I think my rule of thumb is there windows in the room? If so, roll them down. And then there are other standards, but which hopefully it's really an advocacy issue too, because when you talk about schools and talk about businesses, it's really setting these work standards and safety standards that people should be pushing for to make sure that ventilation is included there. So there's that aspect. But for me, it's as simple as yours, really, is look for the windows. Are they open? Is it a larger room, right? Is it circulating? Those sort of rules of thumb, like I live in New York, a tiny New York bar cramming in there with no masks is not appealing to me. I'm sorry. I love grunge bars, and you know, that part of my life is going to be postponed until a little bit later, and I'm okay with that. So, yeah. All right, we should wrap this up now, but I think a last question, which is a really important one, is from Jennifer. How do we convince people to follow the mask guidelines and to get vaccinated? Any tips there? Because it is a hot issue right now, and it's, you know, there's a lot of feelings, frustration, a lot of emotion around this. So how can we navigate past all of these politics, etc.? What are your science communication tips for talking to family members and friends to get them on board with these guidelines to help protect the community?
Yeah, I think with the mask guidelines among the vaccinated, we need to lead by example. You know, own your mask, own it. Own that you're protecting your community. I don't care if I get a weird face at the coffee shop. I'm wearing it and I'm proud to. And we need to normalize that. Just like they normalize it in the Asian countries. How to get vaccinated? This is a really tough conversation. And I say conversation if you're lucky enough to have a conversation. I think that you have to approach these. Well, one, know that the number one reason people change their mind with vaccines, increasing vaccine acceptance, is because they had conversations with their family and friends. So know that you can make a difference even if you're not a scientist or whatever. So know you can make a change. And how do you make that change is you have to have empathy. You have to listen to them. You have to recognize that there are concerns, whether they're legitimate or not, there are concerns, meet them at their world and try and identify that misinformation that they may have and fill it with credible evidence-based data-driven information. And if you don't know where to send that, you know, send them to my site, tell them to talk to their pediatrician. Because if people don't have the information to fill that void, then they will fill it with disinformation or misinformation. And that is what's dangerous. And then also recognize, you know, sometimes you're just not going to get people to change their mind. Other things need to happen. The FDA needs full approval. The employer needs to require it, you know, things that are beyond your control. But as long as you can open a healthy space to have those conversations, I think that's the most important. And it's hard. We're tired of this. We're frustrated of it. But we really need to stop and listen, not just hear, but listen of their concerns and try to address them.
Thank you for that. And those are all really great tips. And to be honest, I've been sort of frustrated on the national conversation or the high level conversation around this, because I think it's very natural because we still have some work to do to really beat this virus and this pandemic. And it's frustrating when, you know, there are still a lot of people who haven't, you know, gotten the vaccine, this thing that can really help with that. So I understand that. At the same time, I do worry about a lot of the messaging that shifts a lot of anger towards people who are unvaccinated. And some of that I understand, right? Because there will be people who maybe for whatever reason have taken a lot of misinformation and are really hard to change. And as you say, Katelyn, you're not going to change everyone's minds, but I worry by having this atmosphere that is really angry and channeled towards individuals. There are a whole bunch of people that we can, you know, reach and have really good concerns, whether that be side effects or the history of the vaccine, you know, that we can really reach. And sometimes I think it's counterproductive for that. So yeah, please, empathy, patience, you know, it's hard. It's not easy. None of us are pretending it's easy, right? But it's important work for all of us. I also had some people signed up. Speaking of trusted sources, I think some people just randomly signed up their hesitant family members to your email list, didn't they? Which probably maybe you want to have consent first, but trusted sources. What was up with that?
Yeah, so it's becoming increasingly apparent that some people are signing up just because you just need an email to sign up to my newsletter. And so people are entering people's email addresses in there. And, you know, I think it's innovative. I think that, you know, maybe it comes from a place of passive aggressiveness, but maybe it also comes mm-hmm. from a place of love and mm-hmm. wanting to get them evidence-based, data-driven resources and information. And so, yeah, it doesn't seem like it's very effective, at least the replies I'm getting back when they realize they're signed up to see an epidemiologist newsletter. But I applaud for the innovation because we need to be innovative, right? This is going to be a grassroots approach. We're past billboards. We need to have one-on-one conversations with people and reach people. So yeah, that's just a funny experience that I continue to be exposed to.
Thank you so much. And we should let you guys in. But before you go, what's the best way for people to connect with your work?
Oh, so I have a Facebook page called Your Local Epidemiologist. And then I actually have a Substack. So it's a newsletter that you can sign up for that actually lands in your inbox instead of social media. And you can go to Substack, go to Your Local Epidemiologist and sign up there.
Thank you so much. And it comes with the fullest recommendation from us at the March for Science. It's such a great Facebook, such a great newsletter, please. And I don't know how you do it. You're really quick anytime the guidelines comes out. So we really appreciate that work.
Yeah, no, I enjoy doing it. And I'm glad to hear that it's helpful.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Jetelina. Your voice and advocacy have been so crucial, inspiring due to this pandemic. And we are so grateful for everything you've done. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right. See you, everyone. All right. That was amazing. Thank you again to your local epidemiologist. She was amazing as usual. So before we go today, we still have another Fauci 5, which we haven't done for a while, but here's this week's one.
My favorite.
All right, so why did I do that? That was the Fijian rugby team. And so they have a wonderful story. Because of COVID, so Fiji is being hit really hard at the moment. It's a tiny island size with a population of San Francisco, and they have thousands of cases at the moment. It's hitting the community hard. The Fijian rugby team had to spend 5 months away from their family to train and sort of to make it to this Olympics. And they just had to fly because of COVID on a freight train, not a normal, on a freight plane, not a normal plane, filled with fish just to make it to the Olympics. And they won the gold medal. After they won, they thanked the health secretary of Fiji for all of the work they've done. And the song that they sang was We Shall Overcome, a local hymn. So I think that's really wonderful. And it's important to remember that right now we are all overcoming a lot of difficult things. And the pandemic is global. We can't forget about other places which are suffering from the pandemic right now. We need to fight for vaccine equity and we need to keep fighting for each other. So yeah, please advocate for vaccine equity and elevate those stories around the world of people overcoming this devastating virus. So thank you for everyone in our wonderful community who joined us today. And before we go, I will say that we will have an advocacy ask, which we'll drop in the comments. As we spoke about, the CDC issued new guidelines this week. But what's important is, I think, as we say, preventing is much better than reacting. We need to take all the layered protections we can right now. So we'll be dropping very soon a petition to have universal mask mandates because we need them around the country. We need them in every state. We need them in every county, regardless of what the rates are at the moment. I think it's clear that we are at risk of many fires in many places and we need to keep as many people as safe as possible. So we will drop that petition in the comments very soon. And please remember that the pandemic doesn't end when we've secured our own safety by getting vaccinated. No one is safe until everyone is safe. We must keep fighting for the safety of others by wearing a mask, taking precautions, and helping others get vaccinated. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you all next time. Bye.